Here, glad to have this turn out. So how many of you guys grow dragon fruit? Quite a few. How many of you prefer the whites over the red ones? Well, that's interesting because that shows you, I mean, where we've gone with dragon fruit. I mean, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, even when we started the project, 12 years ago, everybody's first experience was dragon fruit, and that's all we knew about dragon fruit, white flesh varieties. We weren't as picky as we are today, right? I tell people the story, when we started playing with dragon fruit, we had a lot of fruit from our trials in Irvine, and we developed what we call the Pitahaya dragon fruit groupies. And Barbara, one of our staff persons, I just told her, Barbara sent an email, we've got dragon fruit. First come, first serve. We won't save fruit for anybody, so people would come and take whatever. Following year, they would start asking, well, what do you have? What varieties? What color? Well, we got this, we got that. Okay, thank you. You know, and then by the third year, we ended up with heaps of fruits of white flesh varieties. Nobody wanted them, even for free. They wanted the physical graffiti, the American beauty, the Haley's Comets, and all the tasty varieties. And so I thought, so we had a lot of fruit to get rid of. And we've made many friends over the years, giving away cuttings, giving away fruit. Jim mentioned, we've probably distributed to our field, to our extension activities, more than 6,000 cuttings over the past 10 years. We make cuttings available to growers. If you want to trial out some of the plant material we've got, we've made cuttings available, two cuttings per variety. Up to 10, we won't give you enough to start a farm because the nursery people, they will get mad at us, but we've made plant material available. And the purpose of that is that we learn from what you learn. We want to hear from you, the feedback. There are so many microclimates in San Diego with regards to growing plants that you probably have that experience. What you can grow here, you cannot grow it half a mile down the road or half, down the slope or on the north facing, south facing slope, so everything changes. In dragon fruit, one of the things that we found out is the different varieties adapt differently to different climates. So it's been fun. My big disclaimer is I'm an agricultural economist, and I'm playing with plants out of necessity. We needed to find crop alternatives. Nobody was playing or researching dragon fruit in a somewhat organized manner. So I pretty much picked up from what Paul Thompson started, what Ed and Jim kind of continued, and just try to add a little contribution to the pot. But the whole, most of the credit goes to Mr. Thompson and to you guys, the red fruit growers, because you kept this plant growing it and playing with it in the background. So we've all been messing with it, right, over the past 20 years, and that's been fun. So what I'm gonna tell you about, just an overview, is give you a little bit of background about dragon fruit, some comments about Pitahaya production worldwide, why Pitahaya research, some of the research we've done at South Coast, some observations today. I know, how many of you are commercial growers? I mean, you grow fruit for sale. Well, we got quite a few, and so the comments about the marketing and economic prospect will be useful to some of you as well. And then just kind of wonder, what's next? So in terms of Pitahaya, it is also known as strawberry pear, dragon fruit in Southeast Asia, Pitahaya in Mexico, and Pitaya in Central America. Even in Florida, they call it Pitaya. And the reason is they don't get, as much of an influence with the Mexican Pitaya, which is a saguaro-type cactus that produces another cactus species that produces an edible fruit as well. Native to tropical America from southern Mexico, but that's not necessarily true because we collected some material out of Jalisco state. So it's pretty much from Mexico all the way to northern South America. And contrary to popular belief, it's not native to Asia. I mean, it was taken there by the French at the turn of the 19th century, I think, and then it just became, it just became established all over the place. Types, there are a whole bunch of them. Several species of Hylocereus I've seen in the literature, up to 26 different species reported, mainly differentiated by the shape of the stems, the looks of the fruit, the thorns, and a number of other morphological characteristics. But here in the state, we've got the Ondaros, which is typically the white flesh varieties, and then what we call the Hylozoriums SPP, which is kind of a whole gamut of hybrids of it. I mean, red flesh varieties that have come from Mexico, from Nicaragua, some from Taiwan, and a bunch of hybrids that are the result of the breeding work that Paul Thompson did, or, you know, when with dragon fruit. Solanaceros megalanthus is the yellow or Colombian pitahaya, and that's been going back and forth between the genus Hylozoriums and Solanaceros. I think the latest it was reclassified as a Hylozoriums megalanthus, and it is a very different fruit in general than the other Hylozoriums species. Some of the data we've collected doesn't necessarily, we don't have a lot of data. Well, we do, but it's kind of a winter fruit. It's off season with regards to the other dragon fruit. It starts blooming in June, but we don't harvest until December, January, February. So I tell people jokingly, if they could master the art of growing this thing, they could make some money. Because it is off season, hardly any tropical fruits in the winter here, and it could be profitable.
Who wants to wait 16 months?
I'm sorry?
Who wants to wait 16 months?
Well, 6 months. You know, June to December. It starts blooming in June and then you start picking and then comes in different waves. So you start harvesting and, which is typical, you know, long stump fruit for the most part. It's kind of a longer growing season. So why pitahayas or dragon fruit? I think it's got great potential. I mean, first it makes, in the desert landscape that we live in Southern mm-hmm. California, it makes a great landscape plant. I mean, it's very adaptable. You can shape it or make it grow any way you want. It's not a self, an erect plant. It needs something to grow on. So it's very adaptable in that sense. Most of us, you know, have a retaining wall or a pile of rocks that we can put together. And I mean, it can grow anywhere, really. So it adapts quite well. In terms of water efficiency, that it makes it very attractive for commercial production, especially because most of the crops, the subtropical crops that we grow in the States, tend to be water thirsty, avocados and citrus. And even though dragon fruit, we found out, it is a cactus, you can keep them alive with minimum water. But if you want to grow them for fruit, you need to increase the amount of water you apply. How much more? We're still fine tuning that. So we couldn't tell you exactly what the exact irrigation schedule will be, but it will be also dependent on variety. Some varieties take more water than others, but we're using avocados' water requirements as a benchmark to go. And we got an irrigation trial now that will give us a very good idea of that, because we're going from 0.25, the water requirements of avocado, all the way up to 1.5, trying to find that slot where dragon fruit, and we're doing it with two varieties. Initially, we wanted to do six varieties, but that was an enormous trial, and with little money, you know, it's very difficult to do. I mean, the amount of work that it takes and the infrastructure, and even the layout from a statistical experimental design point of view, it's very difficult to do it that way. So we were doing it with two varieties that are pretty much kind of what's being trendy right now, what we're recommending for commercial planting, those being Physical Graffiti and Lisa. Kind of a hybrid, pink flesh hybrid and a bloody red type Nicaraguan variety, which is a thorny variety. So as far as the other thing is, there's an increasing demand for exotic fruits in the marketplace. I mean, dragon fruit looks very exotic, and one of the problems we had in the past is that the flavor didn't match the look. You bought a dragon fruit, paid $12 a pound, cut it open, beautiful, pure white with black speckles, take a bite, is this it? And I don't know about you, but fool me once, you know, it's on me. Fool me twice, I don't know. I'm not, you know, putting another $10 on a piece of fruit that wasn't as tasty. And so since then, as you might imagine, more fruit become available, and the prices have gone down. I mean, retails, I've seen them lately this season at $5.99 a pound at Vons, even at Walmart, you know, kind of around that price range. To the grower, so in retail, you know, you see them as low as $3-$8 plus at farmers markets. To the grower, prices are around $1.50 to $3.50, depending on color and whether you sort them or not and who you're selling to. I mean, what kind of relationship you have with your buyer. it make, like I said, makes a great landscape plant. Uses is a very diverse fruit. I mean, in Central America, the main use for dragon fruit is juicing. I mean, and typically, you mix them in a pitahaya with pineapple, pitahaya with lemon, pitahaya with guava. It's just the fruit is mainly used to give color to whatever refreshment you're making. The red flesh is used as a colorant for baby food, I believe, by Gerber and other companies for people who are with allergies to red colorants. We are growing it for fresh market. We cannot afford to grow dragon fruit for processed food. I mean, if there are fruit that's been damaged that you can get the pulp, then yeah, that can be an alternative. But the target market for us is the fresh market. In Southeast Asia, they use it for decoration. It's kind of a center table, an offering. I've been told, don't know for a fact, but a kind of an offering to Buddha. I mean, a sign of purity. And so there wasn't a heavy emphasis on flavor. And Southeast Asians, in general, are not into strong flavors as well. So, I mean, that's probably why they didn't spend a lot of effort picking varieties that were kind of a basement sugars. And it's got great potential for value-added products. I mean, there is a company, Pitaya Plus, that was making a blend of dragon fruit juices. We've hired a guy to make some chips and chewy bars, and they were wonderful, especially when on a freeze-dried product, very crispy, very tasty. We've played with dehydrating it, and I think some of the food dehydrators in the market today do a great job of dehydrating dragon fruit, preserving the color and the taste and the looks. They don't lose the color. And they're not as leathery as when you sun dry them, that it takes a, somehow they are very chewy. Many of you guys have tried the ice cream we make, the sorbets we make, and so that's great potential in that sense as well. Beautiful colors. And the other market that might be interesting is this, in the yarn, the textile industry, especially in the organic yarn trade, because I've been told by people who like to knit that they don't find a lot of colors in the organic yarn industry. And we've done some trials with a chemist that the colors that she was getting were really fabulous. Where it is grown, the flags in general represent areas that where we know that dragon fruit is grown. And you can tell this pretty much spans the globe. The heaviest or the largest acreage is concentrated in Southeast Asia, where reportedly there is more than 100,000 hectares under cultivation. And this has been the result of several economic development projects by USAID. New Zealand, Australia have pumped a lot of money to help small-scale growers get into dragon fruit. Lately, we've been had some interaction with people in the Philippines that are trying to plant more commercially as well. People from South Africa and all over the place. In the Americas, Nicaragua has been by far the largest commercial producing country, to the tune of 1,200 to 1,500 hectares under production, mainly red flesh varieties. Hawaii, I'll tell you a little bit more about the U.S. So I mentioned Paul Thompson. I would consider him the father of pitahaya in California. And I forgot to, didn't mention Leo Manuel. Leo Manuel has played an instrumental role as well with the growth of this industry. He's been managed the Pitaya group in Yahoo, and I think that's been by far the single most important way to disseminate information about dragon fruit growing, either backyard or commercial, because a lot of interaction from people all over the world sharing experiences. So that's been right up there as well. Ed Valdivia, big enthusiast, and like I said, we started with the white flesh variety. And then we've shifted, consumer preference and market preference in general has shifted to the bloody red type varieties. So in the US, production is pretty much about 1,200 acres. Florida, they report anywhere from 500 to 600 acres, although more and more is being planted over the past few years. And they used to grow mainly white flesh varieties to supply the Atlantic coast. I've been to some growers and packers in South Florida. And you will see the number of people, Southeast Asian descent, coming in and just getting tropical fruit and then taking it back to the Maryland, Philadelphia, New York, and out that way. And they've been shipping fruit that way. Lately, though, there's been a company, it's called the Red Pitaya Growers of South Florida, that has put in about 100 acres of the Nicaraguan red flesh varieties. And more people are kind of getting into that as well. Hawaii, for the most part, is the Megalanthus type, is the Colombian type. Most people I know grow the yellow pitahaya for the local market. In California, we estimated at about 400 to 500 acres, but we don't know. Perhaps one of you guys in the audience may have put a 50-100 acre plot, and we don't know. I mean, it's people just like to do these things in anonymity, you know, until something happens, and then they come out of the woods, if you will. But it's a guesstimate, you know. I was talking to the guy, Bill Gerlach from Melissa, and he said, Ramiro, how many acres do we have? 5,000? I said, I don't know. I mean, but I think that's way too much. Yes, ma'am.
In Israel, they have 25,000 hectares of pitaya growing in the north of Gaza.
Well, they I believe they had that much. I think, I tell people, when I was scouting for plant material in Nicaragua in the 2004-05, somebody told me, oh, the Israelis were here 25 years ago doing the same thing you're doing. So they had a big project for promotion of desert fruit in plants in the Negev Desert. And what I've been told in meetings with Annette, you were in that meeting with Dr. Mizrahi, he was telling me there is very little acreage left dedicated to pitahaya growing. I mean, it started out as a big project, but with big influx of money from the government. But lately, the acreage that stayed in production is very small. And it also includes a lot of other cacti. I mean, it's not just dragon fruit. They have the kumo, I believe, which is a Cereus peruvianus. And a few other cactus species that they are growing as well. So I couldn't tell you how many acres there is, but I don't think it is 25,000 acres grown in dragon fruit.
No hectares.
Well, no, I don't think it is that much. I mean, given my recent interaction with some people, because I think early on it might have been that many, but yeah, Israel dominates the European market with the Megalanthus, and also with some of their hybrids that they've been able to create. Again, market is turning red. Red and pink varieties are commanding more money, and the thing is what is really red? I mean, because from interacting with people, I found out that people call red anything that isn't white. I mean, if it's got a chain of color, oh, it's red. And from my perspective, I call red what is really red, you know, with the bloody red type. Anything else is kind of pinkish, pink. I call them hot pink, fuchsia. And then the whites, because the preference really, at least what we've seen, is on the bloody red types. I mean, for it's more of a complex flavor. People that like instant gratification will go with the hot pinks because you bite into it, it's a burst of flavor, and then it's gone. It's like eating a watermelon. You get immediate burst of juiciness and water. They tend to be juicier as well. So like I mentioned, Central and South America, it's change color.
Yeah.
Nicaragua is the main producer. I mean, a lot of U.S. companies are now growing into Nicaragua. They've developed.
Going back to the color here a second ago.
Uh-huh.
If they're using the reds to dye yarn, just kind of curious, is the fruit stain clothing beyond repair?
No, it will wash off.
It does.
Yeah. But the thing with the yarn is the lady played with the pulp only, pulp and seeds, pulp and rind, and the acidity of the brew was different. So she ended up with different colors. So it's kind of out of my league really to speculate on the fermentation process and what she was going for. But the color passes through. I mean, I tell people, you eat red flesh varieties, don't run to the doctor tomorrow. I mean, you're fine. going quickly. In Nicaragua, one of the interesting things, and this may be a factor for us here, pitahayas are grown on slopes. So they use it on terraces, and they use it as an erosion control tool as well, especially in areas where they have heavy precipitation. This is near the Masaya volcano in Nicaragua. And you can see that they also grow them on live trees. That is something, and also they are trying to do that as an agroecology system in southern Mexico as well. But I was just talking to someone yesterday and said that's not an option for us. I mean, we cannot afford to keep two plants alive, you know, if only one of them is producing fruit. So you have to keep the tree alive, and that will require some water. I mean, it's a tropical tree. The thing with this is the plants are way too low. This is about 4 feet, 5 feet maybe. And so the plants are on the ground very, very quickly. And when I say dragon fruit grows on everything, and they do. The problem is from a commercial or as a backyard grower is management. You gotta manage your plant, otherwise it's gonna get out of hand and you're gonna, oops, sorry.
We'll see.
All right, you had the right color.
Well, that's probably what happened. So that's Nicaraguan production. This is more of a commercial scale growing, you know, where with heavy plants, and you can see how heavy those plants can get.
Question, how are they pollinating? Here we have to pollinate by hand.
Well, they don't. It's just natural pollinators.
Okay.
And from an entomology perspective, it'll be nice to go in and see what insects do the pollination. I know there is bees, gnats, bats.
And wasps.
Everything. That all kinds of insects there. That's Pitahaya fruit in the market in Nicaragua. And you can see that this fruit won't have necessarily a lot of flavor. Pick that stage. And the reason they pick it that early, what do you think that is? That they pick it that early? I've told this many times, but
the bird?
No, it's a two-legged pest. If the grower doesn't pick it, somebody else will raid their orchards and take it. A lot of fruit theft. They sell five for a dollar. They were selling at that time at five pieces for a dollar. I don't know what the market rate is today, but in Nicaragua, that's significant. I mean, and so they pick them early, first to get them before somebody steals the fruit. And two, like I mentioned, they use them in juice blends. So the flavor, usually when they use them, they will add sugar to it. So the flavor of the fruit is more the color than anything else. It is the sugar and also the quote-unquote benefit of the dragon fruit juice, which is about, you know, it's rumored to have like a digestive aid, you know, it helps with your stomach and all kinds of things. Well, also in sherbet ice creams, it's a beautiful color. This is the Megalanthus. It's the only fruit that has thorns on the only variety or species that has thorns on the fruit. And the thorns will fall off once they get to this stage. You just kind of brush them off and you clip them and it's fine. Problem with this variety, the way we've grown them in Irvine at South Coast, is that we haven't harvested fruit that are of good size. For the most part, we hardly ever pick any fruit that is bigger than 200 grams. Yes, ma'am. There is a Hylocereus species. They call it Andatus for lack of anything else. But there is in Nicaragua, they call it Amarilla Nacional, which is a smooth, similar to the pink Andatus, the pink white flesh dragon fruit, except that the skin is yellow. I tried to source that one. I know it's available in southern Mexico as well, but I haven't been able to get it. So I don't have it in my trial. Oh, really? Okay. No, I haven't seen, and I don't know of anyone here in Southern California that has it. At least I haven't heard of. The only yellow skin fruit that we've seen is the Megalanthus. Quickly, also grown in Asia, like I mentioned, Thailand, Israel. So, varieties, it's actually what got us going with this project. I mean, there's been up to 70 different clones available supposedly in Southern California. As a matter of fact, you talk to somebody who grows dragon fruit, he's got a variety that only he has. You know, it's like, you know, we like to propagate these things, and we got a lot of very prolific breeders, I guess. At the time, there was no data or information available of any on any one clone. So from a commercial perspective, you know, we were promoting the crop, but then people would ask what variety, and they would say, what do you say? We didn't really know what to recommend. So there was a lot, no information available. So at the time I started looking for, and there were a lot of myths about dragon fruit. One, that they wouldn't produce on vertical shoots. They wouldn't set a fruit on a terminal bud. They wouldn't produce without shade. They wouldn't produce fruit without hand pollination. And a whole bunch of other different things. So I started sourcing or trying to identify varieties that were reported to produce fruit without human intervention. I won't say without cross-pollination, because there is a lot of natural cross-pollination happening, especially when you have multiple varieties. But I don't want it to be pollinating plants at night. I mean, it's, you know, my wife wouldn't let me. And so this is what happened. A lot of varieties, like I mentioned, if you have a plant, you got a cutting, and over the years you grew it, it adapted well to your climate, you liked it, you name it after your wife, your daughter, you didn't like it, I guess the mother-in-law comes in handy. And so it's the name, that is. So in terms of commercial varieties, I look for varieties that were reported to produce fruit, like I said, without human intervention. So I found five clones that were grown in Nicaragua that had been selected. And those are the Oricona, Rosa, Zebra, Lisa, and San Ignacio red flesh varieties. And several other clones in Southern California that were promoted as superior, but really there wasn't any data available on them. And then there's also some improved proprietary varieties out of Israel that I wanted to get, but they make you sign a non-propagation agreement and the whole thing. It's kind of a... So the legal implications for my experiment in Irvine, I don't have full control how to keep them people off my trial, so I didn't want to get into that. But in general, it is a big challenge for people trying to grow this commercial, because you don't know what you're getting. And even when you think you know what you're getting, one of the things that we found out in our trial is we replicated or planted in Irvine, it was five replications, each replication containing three plants of 20 different species, of 18 at the beginning, then we added two more. But of the three, of every set of three plants, once we started growing them, we see that two were the same and another, the third one was off, one would look one way, and then all three, so there was a lot of variability. Upon trips to Pine Island Nursery in Florida, which is where I got some of my material, I found out they grow them in big 30, 40 gallon pots. But the thing is, sometimes they got two varieties in the same pots. They send some of their field people get so many cuttings of this variety, and the guy just clips and clips and clips and doesn't necessarily see what, you know, what plant the cuttings are coming from. So you end up with a lot of mixed varieties. And so that's a problem when you're trying to grow, to grow this. And that made us suspicious about the what we had, whether what we had was what we thought we had. And so it became a big problem. So we wanted to evaluate these varieties for adaptation to Southern California. We wanted to develop post-harvest management information because we think this is critical. And then based on the variability that we saw among the plant material, we wanted to get into the genetics of this. I mean, a lot of them, like your American Beauty and the Bien Hoa Red, look very similar. Your all the white flesh varieties look very similar in the field. Bien Hoa White, Vietnamese Giant, and another clone called Mexicana. So we wanted to see what was going on with that. And lately we found out that there is a virus that is affecting this fruit. We don't know what the full effect of the virus is on the plants. We just know they are infected with it, and a lot of plants in Southern California are, and even Florida. Because I think the this kind of a closed circle. The Pine Island Nursery came to California, took whatever they could collect here, took it to Florida. Then they started, they named the varieties differently, and then they are selling them back to us. Isn't that smart? And then we're doing a lot of work on sensor evaluation as well, trying to get into the kind of a volatiles and aroma volatiles to get into that kind of work and see how those aroma volatiles are affected by storage. Yes, sir?
Are there pests that you're looking at?
We'll get to that, hopefully. But yeah, we're how can I say it? we don't, we're not necessarily trying to look at pests, but they come and we have to deal with it, you know? But I'll tell you more about that. So our trial then expanded into Ventura County. We're looking, we have a variety trial in Ventura in an organic system, trying to, there's an organic grower that we're collaborating with and trying out some of the best performing varieties out of Irvine, growing in Ventura, and also in the Coachella Valley. I mean, since it is kind of a more desert environment, we wanted to see how the varieties that are doing well in Irvine would do in a harsher environment in Coachella as well. So, you know, these are all the varieties that we've been playing with. Armando and El Grullo were two later additions to the trial. El Grullo is, I both came upon these quote-unquote varieties by accident. I was crossing the border from Nicaragua into Honduras and I saw this big plant and I asked the guy, does it produce fruit? And he goes, yeah, it gets loaded every year. Can I get some cuttings? So I got some cuttings. And then I brought them to Honduras, then I got the certificate. I don't know how many of you know about CITES, by the way. CITES is the Convention on International Trade of Endangered Species. Dragon fruit falls under CITES, which means that you cannot import plant material into the U.S. legally without a CITES certificate. And I know nobody does that, right? Nobody brings plants from other countries into the U.S.? No? Okay, we're good then. We're good. But yeah, it falls under CITES. And I learned the hard way. I talked to the exporter out of Nicaragua. Once I identified some varieties I wanted to get from Nicaragua, I told the guy, send me X number of cuttings of each variety. They get to, and I told him about CITES. And he goes, oh, no, you know, we got about 1,000 hectares. It's not endangered here. And so I got the plants came to L.A., and I never saw them. They were confiscated by APHIS, and again, I lost $1,200 worth of plants, I mean, with all the paperwork and stuff. So the following shipment, I got the CITES in place and everything. I go to get my plants, and I'm speaking to the inspector, you know, and he goes, what do you need this for? Well, it's a research project that we're doing. I said, well, you don't need a CITES. It's for research, you don't need it. And I go like, after I had lost my initial shipment. But those are the things that you have to deal with. And so what happens with this, APHIS confiscate plants that come in or smuggled in, and then what they do, they put them out for adoption. And that's how some of these unique plant species end up in botanical gardens. APHIS will put a call out, hey, you know, we've got X number of items of this genus and species, who wants to rescue it? And that's when your quail gardens, your botanical gardens all over the country, you know, depending on what environment they're in, they will claim them and then they will be sent to them. There's a story about a grower in San Diego who was importing some exotic plants from China or Asia. And the plants got confiscated by APHIS. Somehow he found out that what botanical garden had rescued him. This person hires somebody to go in and steal those plants. and then, I mean, the way we know, the reason we know is because he got busted, you know, and apparently he got some in prison or something or some heavy penalty. El Grullo is a selection out of Mexico. I was traveling in the state of Jalisco, and again, came upon this tree going up in the canopy of another huge shade tree, and it's kind of a latest addition to the trial. Very, very promising as well. So we do have like Pitahaya guy. I walk you through some of these varieties really quickly. The first six, what's red like this shape is all Nicaraguan varieties, very similar in terms of morphological characteristics. So I won't say much about them until we get to the, see Rosa, Orecona, Lisa, Sinespinas. I'll mention that this is the only thornless variety that we have. It's very frost sensitive though. It's like, you know, it happens. Something has a very good characteristic and then it's kind of hard to grow it, right? I mean, it happens with the Colombian Pitahaya and it's very similar to this. But in terms of how the fruit looks, it's got a natural shine to it. It's very, it looks like it's been waxed, waxy. And based on the comments we got from you guys participating at one of our Pitahaya festival, it was rated as the highest in terms of external appeal. It was the fruit that people liked the most in terms of how it looks. Then San Ignacio, Mexicana, is a white-fledged selection. And I'll mention this because look at the bricks, it's 14 degrees, 14 on this, on the brick scale, which is about two points higher than your typical white-fledged variety. Apparently this came from Mexico, but I imported it through Nicaragua. They had spent a little bit of time selecting for flavor, so sugar was important.
Could you put Sinus Venus on the
Yeah, certainly. This is a plant that would do well in a protected environment, by the way.
Are these slides on your website?
Yeah. Yeah, they are. Mexicana, Colombiana, as you can see, the fruit's very small. Valdivia Roja, I got this coming cream from Francisco Valdivia. Kind of different, and this is kind of what we would call the Ocampones species. Very low acidity fruit on the red flesh varieties. I mean, most of the red flesh varieties tend to be high on the acid, but this one is very low on acid, and so the flavor, it's kind of different. It's where you get more like an aftertaste, it's very subtle. And you kind of like drinking wine, I guess. You got to swirl it around to get the expression of the flavor. Bienhoa Red is from Bienhoa Farms in Colbrook. Bienhoa White, Delight, is one of Paul Thompson's hybrid. American Beauty. This is one of Paul Thompson's, no, actually, this is Megalanthus, but it's actually went to Pine Island from Paul Thompson as well. And you will see some of the names that these guys in Florida came up with. I wish I had been invited to that party where they decided to name this variety. Because you got into Haley's Comet, Physical Graffiti, Vietnamese Giant, Yellow Dragon, Soul Kitchen, Armando is the name of the guy that gave me the cuttings, El Grullo is the guy that that I selected. But in the on the Florida varieties, the other names they have are like LA Woman, David Bowie, Cosmic Charlie, Voodoo Child, Purple Haze, and Natural Mystic. I mean, must have been, must have had a good time. In addition to the 18 varieties, I've collected about 50 additional accessions that I'm just growing for observation. And they all, a lot of them are duplicates of the ones I have in the replicated trial, and some others are just plants that I've been getting from growers, trying to see how they do in Irvine and whether we measure the breaks and see how much fruit they produce without hand pollination. And I'm not saying by that these plants are either self-fertile or self-pollinating. And that's a big debate, and we're trying to get our hands around that with some of the varieties we're growing. But the fact is, I've got a ton of plant material, different plants growing, so there is a lot of cross-pollination happening naturally. If you grow these varieties, don't grow them in a monoculture. I mean, grow one, two, or three different species so that you have, but make sure that the species are synchronous with regards to flowering. Not only the day, but also the time of day. Mm-hmm. Delight is a variety that the flower, the leaf gets pollinated before the sun goes down, like four, you know, before, right at dusk. I was waiting to take a photo of bees going into a flower of Delight, and my surprise was that bees were coming out before the flower opened. So the stigma is sticking out right at the tip of the flower. When bees land on them, they just go in, and that's when they get pollinated. And they go in to get pollen, not to harvest pollen. Valdivia Roja is a flower that opens up at 10 at night or after. So you cannot, those two will never cross-pollinate because by the following morning, there's the light probably not gonna be viable, and there's not gonna be any pollen left on the flower to pollinate your Valdivia Roja. So synchrony in terms of dates and synchrony in terms of hour of the day is very critical, and you gotta match those varieties in terms of to make sure that you get through. Yes, sir?
Isn't it a lot of the beetles that are doing the pollinating at night?
Well, not at night. We don't have a lot of beetle activity. I mean, we do have, I mean, it's occasional beetle will show up, but mostly bees, either right at, you know, late in the afternoon or very early in the morning. So what we found out is that most varieties adapted fairly well to growing environment in Irvine, full sun. although these varieties really were the ones that performed better with regards to adaptation, the ones that look well winter or heat of summer. Most of them produce well without hand pollination. Again, there is a lot of cross-pollination happening naturally. I mean, a lot of bees, and this is mainly because of the availability of various species. Physical Graffiti, Soul Kitchen, Delight, Lisa, and San Ignacio were the most productive varieties in our trial. Most varieties did well without shade, but I would tell you that if you try to grow American Beauty, AKA BNO Red, in the inland valleys of San Diego, is gonna be a struggle because it's gonna get hammered by the sun and the cold. It's a great variety, but I wouldn't grow it for, you know, it, without protection. It's the other thing is very tasty, and it would do great for those who grow commercially for local markets. But it the skin is so thin that the fruit bruises. It's like the analogy is Hass versus Fuerte, with the American Beauty being on the Fuerte category. You know, you look at them and they bruise. That's pretty much it. And that's some of that with the pink varieties, although the skin and the density of the pulp is heavier as well, so they hold up a little bit better in storage and shipping. The fruit size and quality, for the most part, was very good, except for the Colombiana.
What varieties were you testing up in Carlsbad there when up at the farm, which is no more?
A subset of these, pretty much the same.
Really?
Yeah. External appearance, like I told you, Cinespina is rated the highest in terms of how the fruit looks to the eye. Lisa, Physical Graffiti in that order. In terms of flavor, American Beauty and Bienhoa Red, American Beauty and Bienhoa Red came at the top consistently, and they are the same. We found out it's just two names for the same clone. Physical Graffiti is a close second. Delight and Cinespina and Lisa were also very flavorful. Problem with this variety is when you're tasting, and you probably know this, I mean, it's when you're tasting fruit, it's kind of hard to compare two pieces of fruit because you never pick them at the exact same maturity. And so it's very difficult to make that assessment, and we do it repeatedly over time, but in general, they swap one place, but in general, they hold up fairly well. Some people like one variety versus the other, but they are in the same type, so you know, it tells you that they are kind of in the ball. We also suspected that the color of the fruit may kind of affect your perception of flavor, so we did a kind of a blind test, you know, where we put the fruit behind IR lights to mask the color, so they all look the same color, and still, you know, the Bienhoa Red, you can see they swap places, but they came up on top. I mean, the American Beauty Bienhoa Red. There's clear differences among varieties in terms of sugars and acids. And this is where you gotta pay special attention to when you harvest. We've tried to develop a color index with some work with Marita Cantwell, because you pick this by color. And the post-harvest work has shown that the quality of the fruit is determined at the moment you pick it. The problem with the white flesh varieties is that for the most part, we pick them too late. We let them go to full color on the plant. And at that time, there is no acidity left. So the problem with the sugars on the white flesh varieties rarely make it past 12. And the acid, there isn't a lot of acidity there. So if you let them go as the fruit ripens, that acid keeps going down. So a 12 scale on the bricks, a 12 on the brick scale with some acid on the, with some acidity on the fruit, you will have a fruit with some personality. But if you just have no acidity, it's just gonna be bland. I mean, it's not sweet enough to make it feel sweet. On the Nicaraguan, on the bloody red varieties, those fruits have a lot of acidity. Therefore, if you let them go to full color, you will enhance the flavor because it won't be as tart. And the bricks is 16, in the 16 and a half range, so you're gonna have a better expression of flavor. And so on the other varieties, on the in-betweeners, you know, your pinks, your fuchsia pink varieties, those is kind of the same as the, but they are sugar-wise, they are in the 18 range, so they are gonna be sweet. So you have more flexibility in terms of when you pick them. But then it depends on what you're picking them for. If you're for your own house, you can afford to almost let them go to full color. If you're picking them for sale, I would say the rule of thumb is pick them at 2/3 color. Because then, and it's kind of a subjective measure, but you know, you don't want them to be fully red. You want to see some shades of green so that you have that acidity and the color, you know, and the sugar in there. So in terms of what I was telling you about other projects that we've conducted, I collaborated with Greg Doohan, who is a molecular guy up at UCR, and we've got this, and we just published a paper on this as well, and I can send you, I'll give you my email at the end if you want a copy of the paper, I'll send it to you. This is just kind of a brief summary, where we look at about 230-something different samples, accessions that we have in our possession, and look at their DNA. The idea was to eliminate duplicates, to see how they fit, you know, in terms of genetic relationship. And what we found out is that Bienhoa red and American Beauty genetically identical, the Light, Halley's Comet, and Physical Graffiti, those are hybrids from Paul Thompson, and they are not identical, but they are within one marker. So because I think in his breeding work, he reversed the order of the parents, and like Halley's Comet, parent is the opposite of Physical Graffiti, and so they are very close together. Soul Kitchen and the other varieties and the other white flesh varieties, very almost identical genetically as well. Although if you're going to have the white flesh varieties are self-pollinating, self-fertile. So if you're going to have a white flesh variety for pollination purposes, just to make sure that you have some fruit, I would go with Soul Kitchen. Reason is, on the and maybe you've had different experiences, but the Vietnamese giant, the Bien Hoa white, or the Hylocereus and Dattos in general, has a very compact season. Two floches and you get about 90% of your fruit. Typically in Irvine, we harvest most of our white flesh varieties in August, mid-August to September, and we're done. The Soul Kitchen has got a longer season, and it's a very prolific bloomer. I mean, it just produces a lot of fruit. So if you want pollen that you know for sure is self-fertile and that will give you pollen for an extended period, I would go with the Soul Kitchen. It's a vigorous, it's hardier than the other Vietnamese, than the other Hylocereus and Dattos species. Yellow Dragon and Colombiana are the same. And all the Nicaraguan selections were very closely bundled, with the exception of Sinus Spinach, and the fact that it's a thornless variety tells you the genetic makeup is probably different, so it kind of stood out by itself. But these were very similar, except that these were closer together, you know, and they grouped like this. Valdivia Roja and El Grullo, again, selections out of Mexico, very similar in shape, and they are pretty much identical as well. As a backyard grower, or even as a producer, well, as a producer, you want to grow what the market wants. But, you know, in terms of you for your home gardens, what variety you select will be determined by, you know, what you like.
Have you ever looked at Thailand?
At what?
In Thailand, for varieties?
No, I haven't. I've tried to, you know, it's way too far out, and we couldn't go out that far. And the import permits is what? Really kind of limited where we went with this. And the other thing is, I didn't see much color diversity in terms of what's grown in Thailand. It was, for the most part, when I was looking at these, mainly white flesh varieties. And we were more concentrated on variety of color. Yes, Jim?
When you say Bolivia Roja, that's the one from Carlsbad Ranch?
Yeah.
Right. I call it Valdivia Ranch, so that I don't know.
Oh.
Confuse it with something that Edgar might have produced.
Well, we called it Bolivia Red from the start, it's little variations in name. I mean, and even here, you get into argument that it should be called dragon fruit, not pitahaya, or pitahaya and not dragon fruit. But, you know, that I'm not the one. Or pitaya. So that's for you guys to decide. I know in terms of marketing, dragon fruit is probably a more appealing name to it, but I'm not going to dictate how you call it. So in terms of relative cold and heat tolerance, The blue is cold hardiness, the red is heat tolerance. And this is a very subjective evaluation that Gary Tanizaki, or one of our staff research assistants, and I did. We went plant by plant, scoring them on a scale of 1 to 5. The higher the number, the more tolerant to either one. And you can see that, I mean, there are like on the Colombiana, the Sinespinas, they were pretty low. So it's, again, it's our own estimation based on looks. And this is what I tell people when they go to our field trial in Irvine. I don't need to tell you anything, really, about these plants for you to figure out which plants are doing better. I mean, they are all treated the same. I've neglected them equally. I haven't sunk to one or the other. So it's just, you know, you look at them, you will have an idea of what plants are doing well. And this is what I normally tell people. Look at the plants that you feel, see what appeals to your eye, and then I can tell you about some of the data we've collected on each specific set of plants, you know, whether about the fruit, the yields, the quality of the fruit, and all that. And it works well that way. In terms of breaks, you can see that, like I mentioned, the Colombiana, by far the highest breaks, usually over 20, 20 and a half, 21. So that's why people consider it the best tasting variety of them all. But it's all about sugar. Close second would be your American Beauties and Viejo Red. And then you get into, so the flavor in terms of sugar is packed in the middle. You know, your fuchsia color, except for Colombiana, all the fuchsia color, hot pink varieties are going to have the highest bricks. In terms of fruit production per plant over 3 years, clearly physical graffiti outproduced most of it. And then the cluster of Lisa, San Ignacio, Delight, and Soul Kitchen is where, you know, this kind of a second tier in terms of fruit production per plant. And this is in grams. So, you know, physical graffiti produces only 25 kilos of fruit per year. Again, this is without hand pollination. We didn't sort by marketable yield, you know, or grades. There are grades out in marketplace. But in general, if you do cross-pollinate or if you do hand-pollinate, spend some time pollinating, you will have a more uniform crop, uniform fruit size. Yes, sir?
Physical graffiti did you say Viejo Red were the same?
No.
Well, which one was it?
American Beauty and Viejo Red.
Okay.
Viejo Red 10 and 13.
Armando, Ramiro. Have you grown neon?
No, I don't.
That seems to be very, you know, I have a plant all by its lonesome and everything that blooms sets fruit.
Huh.
I was also going to mention that drying slices maybe a quarter inch thick in a dehydrator really jazzes up the taste.
Yeah.
So that works.
I've been playing with a dehydrator this year, and I the first batch of fruit a couple, about 6 weeks, 2 months ago, I dried out quite a few, and it comes out great. I mean, just based on, like you said, the thickness of the slice, based on the dehydrator recommendation. I've never used one, by the way, so it's kind of been fun. Now I'm addicted. I wouldn't recommend it to dry blueberries, which was the reason I actually got it, unless you. The recommendation is you got to puncture a hole on every piece of blueberries to accelerate the drying process. And I say,
yeah.
God. Yes. or you kind of boil it, dip them in hot water just to burst the skin a little bit for them to dry. But then that affects the flavor. Because it's kind of a cycle. We have a blueberry trial, and we didn't know what to do with all the fruit that we were harvesting, really. Couldn't sell it, didn't get the market end of it ready. So I was given as much fruit as I could, and so this chart kind of summarizes everything, and this is kind of available in our website as well. So in terms of growing pitahaya, we have in our website, a lot of things are kind of hard to say with words, so we've done a series of videos showing you how to prep cuttings, how to propagate, how to harvest properly, how to prune, and I'll get into some of these details as long as we have a little bit of, you know, let me know how I'm doing with time, Jim.
you're about over, but it's lunchtime pretty quick. However, if you want to continue on a little bit, you can. But,
well, up to you guys. This was kind of an intermediate end to it, but I got more to tell you. We're going to go into the growing and the propagation part. Okay, quickly, site selection, the biggest thing is drainage. I mean, I will tell you, they don't like, the worst conditions for dragon fruit plants are saturated soil and cool weather. I mean, the moist and cold are their worst enemy. They just melt. The plants, you know, get into this yellowish, they just melt, literally. So well-drained soils is the key. Soil type doesn't really matter, really, as long as you don't have it saturated with water. As a matter of fact, in Guatemala, they told me, you know, you don't plant them, you just toss them as you go, and you hope they land on a rock. And the reason they say land on a rock is because if they land on the soil, there is so much precipitation that the plants will just rot. But on the rock, they will start sending aerial roots, and then the first plant just kind of wraps the rocks, and it will hold it, and then you have a thicket that grows on that pile of rock. So it works well, and it's all related to moisture. Propagation, cutting is by far the preferred way to do it. I mean, for several reasons. You reduce variability with your seedlings. You know you're cloning the plant that you're starting with. And if you start with a cutting that is anywhere from 12 to 18 inches, you can have fruit on that plant within a year time after transplant. Mm-hmm. Propagation cycle is we prune our plants for production in the fall. As soon as they are done with the harvest, which kind of varies because depending on weather, we have a heavy load of fruit on our plants into January. So we prune them as soon as we're done with the last quote unquote flush. Then we dry out, we cure those cuttings for a couple of weeks, and if you're propagating them, I would say put them in pots in a somewhat protected environment. After your last your tough weather is gone, you know, in the spring, put them in the field, and typically that plant will give you some fruit the following summer. If any of you go to our field trial coming up at the, on the 22nd on our field festival and field day, you will see that a one-year-old planting, really. You probably saw it last year, some of you that went last year, where we had just transplanted, and you will see the plants today, loaded with flowers, and hopefully loaded with fruit as well, because we did hand pollinate, mainly because that trial is kind of a two varieties, Lisa and Physical Graffiti, so we knew we had to pollinate by hand to make sure that we get a good set. Seeds germinate quite easily, readily, 85-90% germination rate. But you gotta baby these plants for a period of time. And depending on varieties, you know, you can get I've seen in the literature anywhere from 3 to 6 years to produce fruit from seedling. So it's kind of a longer time. And the other thing is the variability. I mean, you don't know, every seed is gonna be a different plant. But one way to expedite if you're doing it for breeding work, grafting works very well. I mean, you can graft some of your seedlings maybe onto a mature plant, and then you can expedite production that way. But again, I haven't gotten into that yet, but it's something that grafting is possible, like I said, but the benefits aren't quite yet. There are a number of things that we've been looking at, and because we haven't had enough money to lure, you know, some of our campus-based scientists to work with us on this, Gary and I started out working with a specialist at UCR screening these varieties for tolerance to root rot, the Phytophthora cinnamomum. So we haven't made, neither Gary nor I have made a very compelling argument to the guy to score the plants. I mean, we inoculated the plants, we did all the groundwork, and then we took the samples to Riverside and waited to see what happens. So my fear is that it's going to be a failed experiment at some point because it's not going to give us any result. But those are the kind of things that we're looking at. If we were to find one of these varieties that is tolerant to Phytophthora, we know we're planting plants on Phytophthora and loaded soil. So that would be a benefit of grafting. Then we can use that as a rootstock and plant something on it. Cactus virus X is another thing. If we were to identify a species or a clone that is tolerant or resistant to the virus, then we could graft onto it as well. Because the cactus, the virus is very aggressive. I mean, it's propagated by root grafting. Two roots underground come into contact, they will get the virus. Two limbs rubbing against each other, that's how it's propagated. Mechanical is the biggest thing, though. Your pruning shears, your pruning equipment, you gotta sanitize them. And there are a number of recipes for signing, you know, sanitizers to do that. Jim has his hand up.
One last thing that there's a fellow that told me that by hitting the plants with clover at the right time of year really kicks everything into bloom. I don't know if that's...
I couldn't tell you, Jim. Fertility work is not something that we've done up until this year. Finally, there is a lab in Ventura County that has offered to work with us, trying to really get at the nutrient requirements of dragon fruit. So when you send in a batch of samples, the other thing is, when we're talking about tissue samples, where do we get the samples from? So the way we approached it was, we took samples from very tender growth, kind of an intermediate growth, the previous flush, and then mature growth. And I sent it to the lab, and we just ran a, they just got done analyzing those. And the reason is trying to see what's in the plant, then right at bloom, you know, right on at bloom. Then we're gonna look at the same samples, same plants, right at when the fruit is on the plants, when, you know, right at harvest, and analyze those for fertility as well. And then we're gonna analyze the fruit to see how much nutrients come on the fruit. And then we'll try to replenish that. But that work is kind of underway. We don't really know. We shoot from the hip on that, and we pretty much apply a quarter of triple 20, I mean, 4 ounces of triple 20 per plant on a quarterly basis. With the exception that in spring, we substitute that with a triple 14 that includes microelements, the triple 14 plus minor elements, and a slow-release fertilizer that carries through the bloom season. And the plant seems to respond. I haven't compared it to anything else, so I like to think that they respond well to it, you know.
Hey, Ramiro, I would like to report that, you know, the plants, they last longer. I have my plantation 17 years, and they never die with the root problem. The only problem I have is they die because of the weather. Hot, cold weather, or too much heat. Last year, I lost half of my plantation by the cold weather. That is the only enemy.
I'll mention about multiple things. One is a stunted. The plant just gets to a point where they just sit there, get some sort of a dull, darker green color. Instead of producing really normal shoots, you see a lot of like they look abnormal. It's like bubbles, you know, like balloons, really small. That they just sit there and don't flush. Neither fruit nor growth. Reddening of the stems is another symptom. Yeah, they start turning kind of reddish. They enlarge, they just swell up, and when you cut them, the flesh, normal color of the flesh is kind of a very lime green. You know, when you do a diagonal cut on it, it's a lime green color. When the virus is present, what we see is kind of a yellow, almost like an egg yolk type color, very yellowish color. Curling on the stem. I used to think it was associated with variety, that some varieties just like to produce these curly stems, and apparently not. Apparently it is a result of a virus infection. And overall stunting. I mean, they just sit there, they don't do anything. You know, they stay alive, but they just sit there. Yes, ma'am.
What causes the scabbing?
The what?
The scabbing.
I don't know about it. Maybe trips. It's probably insect damage that, you know, right at the when the fruit started to, we see a lot of thrips in our field trial here in Irvine. Flower thrips will probably cause some of that, and as the fruit grows, ants may do some of that as well. I mean, it's probably insect related. I couldn't tell. They're probably lower priced. And sunburn may be a factor as well, I mean, if it gets exposed. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Earlier you said they need full sun, but then it says it's protected from the sun. So how much sun do you protect it from?
Well, I didn't say that about all varieties. Some varieties will need protection. Others you can grow in full sun. How much shade? We don't know. And that is something, I wouldn't go past 30% though. I mean, that's my guess, my guesstimate. And the reason is, under shade, you will have beautiful plants, but you will hardly get any flowers. I mean, the shade inhibits blooms. And we're in the business of growing fruit, so I tell people try growing as an understory crop to avocados, but the density of the canopy in avocados, the plants just go to the top. You end up with these skinny shoots that just go up to the top, and then when there is an opening, they will just kind of stop growing, and then you will have a thicket high on those trees. And that's one of the reasons they call it monkey's food in the tropics. Because the plants germinate in the soil, they just go up these trees, you know, 40, 50 feet up in the air, they find a place, they start just thickets of fruit that nobody can get it. And then eventually the base of the plant, the roots will rot and whatever. So they will survive pretty much with moisture coming in through the air. I mean, they are palm tree plants, so they get their moisture mostly from the air.
Yeah, if you have 3 foggy weeks and then 1 hot day, they'll burn.
Oh yeah, they'll just melt. Yes, sir.
Earlier you mentioned that there are some varieties that the flowers tend to open before the sun goes down in the late evening.
Yeah.
Which varieties are most likely to bloom earlier in the day?
Oh, the light is probably the earliest one. The light and some of the white bush varieties, they usually open up early in the, right at dusk. You know, early in the evening, even the Mexican, the Nicaraguan selections, they will open up fairly early in the evening as well. It's just the Mexican, the Embrujo, and Valdivia Roja, those tend to open really late in the evening.
You guys, if you're interested in eating, and Ramiro probably is interested in eating, maybe if you have further questions, you can just look for that green shirt.
And sales pitch, we are doing a pitahaya seminar. It's an all-day pitahaya growing seminar up in San Marcos on the 21st. It's a Friday, followed up by a pitahaya festival and field day in Irvine, where we can go see all our trials. And so one is kind of a reinforcement of the previous day, with the exception that in the field day it's more festive. We get to eat fruit, you know, we go on tramps to the fields and different stations. You can see firsthand the plants, how they look in the field. And so if you are interested, please join us. It's fun. Both days are pretty fun and packed with information, where we go into more detail about each of these project results and all that.
How do we sign up for that?
If you go to that website, this isn't early on, or shoot me an email, and I'll just kind of go to the end of my... So we didn't talk about a bunch of different things. I'm sorry, I'm just...
But I would recommend all of you
to... Oh, if you're interested in price, market and price information, I would say go to this site and just follow the thread that is listed there. Then you will see what's reported on pitahaya prices.
September.
Everybody got it?
September the 21st and the 22nd. It's 2 days. You're going to taste a lot of pitahaya.
One of the things, for those of you that I'll make this comment before I go on, that are considered growing dragon fruit, the organic segment of pitahaya production, I think, can be a very profitable niche for us in Southern California. Our plants fruit when there is no rain at all. I mean, it's spring to summer, and that is monsoon season in Florida, which will be our biggest domestic competitor, and monsoon season in Nicaragua. So I doubt that they will be successful at trying to grow dragon fruit organically, whereas we, I think, can do it very successfully here. And you can see the price, the difference in price on the conventional versus organic trade. I mean, it's significant, so.
And what were the dates? 21st and 22nd of this month.
My email is there. If you don't get to the website, just shoot me an email and I can send you the information to sign in.